Also, before I even start, I want to say, this computer is going to ruin my last joke. Right, okay, you'll see what I mean. I am Sarah Wiseman, and I am a researcher in HCI in the Department of Computing here at Goldsmiths. Now, we have some in tonight. Right, so what does HCI mean? It stands for Human-Computer Interaction, and you've already seen some of that tonight. You saw Kate with the sex robots, you saw Mick with the wicked cool guitar. Unfortunately for you guys, those are just small subsets of HCI, and I'm going to talk about the boring, less sexy stuff. My PhD was on typing. I'm not joking, here we go. So, what am I actually going to talk to you about tonight? Tonight what I'm going to do is hopefully scientifically ruin lots of computer interfaces that you see in movies and TV. Now, we're a very technologically astute population now, and that means that people that are making films and TV, they can no longer kind of make interfaces in MS Paint. They kind of have to try a bit harder now, because we all know what things look like. And that means that a lot of films actually employ people to make interfaces for them. One of the most famous examples is probably The Martian. Now, in The Martian, they got a team in, and they made hundreds of different interfaces for the whole film. And the way they did this was they actually went and met with NASA, and they discussed with NASA, what are your design standards, and what science do you need to represent in your interfaces? And by doing this, they came up with something that was scientific, accurate, and precise. And that was quite fantastic. It made the film what it was. Another endeavor that has employed an interface designer is Taylor Swift's Bad Blood music video. I'm not joking, they actually employed someone to create the interfaces for this. And I can only assume they went through the same rigorous processes to ensure that their interfaces were fierce, badass, and independent, like Swift herself. It's Taylor Swift. Right, I don't want to talk about that, because that's good interfaces. I want to talk about the crap ones, okay? I think that's more interesting. And what we're going to do is we're going to look at some crap interfaces and work out what the HCI research tells us about them and why they're crap. So, rule number one. Often they'll ignore good design patterns. Now, to show you an example of this, I'm going to have to show you quite a gruesome scene from Die Hard. Oh, that is the directory, right, that Bruce McLean, when he walked into the lobby, has to use when he's trying to find out where his estranged wife is. John McLean hates this interface because ultimately it tells him his estranged wife has changed her name. I hate this interface because it's disgustingly designed. It's really, really poor. If you had to use this, you would struggle. But let me tell you why. Cast your mind back to the last time you were late for a train and you didn't have your tickets. You were running there and you were desperate to know if you were going to be able to make the train on time, but before you could get to the train, there was one interface standing in the way, and it was this interface. You ran up to it. Furiously trying to work out how you could enter your reference number. You got it on your phone, you get to the interface, and suddenly you've just forgotten how to use letters. Why can't I type anything on this? I've known how the alphabet works since I was very young. Why can't I get this now? Well, the reason that you're struggling to use this interface is something called semiotics. Now, semiotics is the way that we interpret signs in the world to tell us what's actually happening. And research has shown that this plays a part when we come up to an interface. And it turns out, what you'll do is take little cues from the environment before you're even looking at the detail of that interface. And what's happening here is that there's another way that letters are arranged that we're very used to. And that way that they're arranged is also the way that we are commonly entering in letters. And so what we do when we see a load of letters that are arranged in three or four rows is think, QWERTY, this is defo QWERTY. And so what's happening when you run up there, your brain is thinking, don't worry, this is QWERTY, we know where all those letters are. And then you actually look at it and suddenly you've forgotten how it all works. So what I want you to take away from this is that you shouldn't deviate from design patterns. They're there for a reason. Everyone knows how to use them. And secondly, if you're ever late for a train, you can just stop and think, oh, I'm damn well like Bruce Willis here. Maybe that'll kick down and make you feel better. Okay, second thing, overly specialized GUIs. GUI, or GUI, stands for Graphical User Interface, and this is one of my favourite things that interface designers do in TV and films, and it's what I call exposition OS. It's what happens when really lazy filmmakers can't be bothered to do the clever thing in the plot or with the character dialogue, and they just stick the exposition right in the interface there. So here, this computer is being audited by the Inspector General's office. It's quite verbose there. So what are you going to do, right? What are you going to do if you've got a character that's sending an email and you need to let the audience know who they're sending that email to? Just make the toolbox massive! Then they'll know what to look at. What are you going to do if your character is desperately trying to send a recorded voice message to his son before he dies, but it fails? What are you going to do? Well, you're just going to create another overly ambitious message. Fail to upload recording to Chad Velcoro, which is the lead character in True Detective 2. Chad Velcoro is stupid one, but still it has merits. ChadVelcoro2@gmail.com. That is nothing that you'd see on a phone, but because they need it in the exposition, they just stick it in there. And my personal favourite, my personal pet hate, is when they make inputs overly specialised. Now, if you're a hacker, you're probably used to getting into systems that you shouldn't be and feeling very unwelcome in these computer environments. So the last thing that you would probably expect, what happened in the film Masterminds, is a beautiful graphical user interface. Hackers will be aggressively prosecuted. Do you still wish to enter? A beautiful user interface. Castle themed, medieval, that's nice. Why write code when you can click on skeletons to hack into something? Speaking of castles, the TV show Castle. One of the tech gurus, he's desperately trying to launch a cyber nuke. We all know what they are, so that's, I don't need to explain that. He's going to launch a cyber nuke onto another computer. How's he going to do this? A single little line of code? We're going to stick a massive launch button on a cyber nuke on three different screens. Then the audience will get it. Yeah, then they'll get it. Why do I hate these interfaces? They're just so overly engineered and it's completely pointless and, in fact, inefficient. So lots of studies have shown that actually using graphical user interfaces is far less efficient than using text-based interfaces when you're an expert. I'm taking you from the stage. Text-based interfaces are far better. Think about it. When you're writing a text document and you need to copy and paste something, what do you do? Do you stop typing, get the mouse, move up to the edit button, click uncopy, and then do the same paste? You don't do that. It's stupid and it's slow. What you end up doing is using Control-C, Apple-C, and Control-V, Apple-V, to do the copy and paste action, because it's so much quicker to use the text interface. And so when you see hackers on these TV shows and movies using graphical interfaces, you know that it's very inefficient, they're probably paying too much, they're probably being paid too much for their job, and I don't think they're probably that very good at it. So it's probably not realistic is what I'm saying. Okay, issue number three. I've been talking about hacking, and hacking is a really easy target because hacking is done really shockingly badly on most TV and movies. But I'm going to talk about the specific thing that I hate about it, and it's best shown by this GIF. That's four hands, two people, typing on a keyboard because it's really urgent that they get this done. That's ridiculous. That wouldn't ever happen. Like, the only thing I can think is that they're typing sweater dresses and non-emolium neon. Those are the two longest words you can type with just your left hand and just your right hand. Needs Hugh Jackman to hack into this interface. It usually takes 60 minutes, he needs to do it in 60 seconds, and and there's a gun! So, obviously, there's another thing happening. obviously, there's no way that Hugh Jackman could possibly like, get into this hacker's interface. He needs an hour, he's only got a minute, there's no possible way he could. Okay, no, he manages it. That's ridiculous. Let's explore why that's ridiculous using typing behavior. So, typing behavior, we know that let's create the best possible situation for the 60 minute, 60 second thing. Say the 60 minute person is a novice and the 60 second person is Hugh Jackman, he's an expert. We know that novices type much slower than experts, and that's because they don't know where the keys are on the keyboard. They'll often use a hunt and peck thing. But as an expert user, you can move a lot quicker, you know where your fingers need to move to, and a lot of research has shown that, in fact, you don't need to be taught as a touch typist. Whatever strategy you have for getting to those keys is optimal, and a lot of like motion capture studies have shown this. It's very cool. So, we know that even if he was an expert typist, we'll give him a 5x speed boost for that. How else can we boost his speed? Well, if you have knowledge of the material that you're typing, if you're an expert, you recognize all the words that you're typing, then you're going to be able to type that a lot faster than someone who's typing random or unknown words. And that's because typing isn't just about your fingers, it's about your brain as well. If your brain recognizes the words, then you're able to predict what's coming next, and you can type faster. So we'll give him a 2x speed boost for that. So we know a novice takes 60 minutes, an expert takes 12 minutes, and we give him a 5x speed boost. If we then say he has knowledge of the material, we'll give him a 2x speed boost, which means he has 6 minutes. It all adds up to something bad, right? He doesn't manage to do it in less than a minute. There's no way that scene can be accurate. I'm highly suspicious of the film as a documentary. I think it might be fictionalized, and I have a lot of problems with it. What is this incredibly verbose and detailed message that has appeared on the screen behind me? I don't need to read it to you because it has been displayed on an interface. Phew, thank goodness, Exposition OS saved the day. Thank you very much, everyone.